saying that this is the only place where this can be crossed. Red needs a little help. The form of the air volunteers. Ah, we've had a change in the programme, so running in from the left, ladies and gentlemen. A 1930s fighter formation. Just give him a round of applause, because that was an outstanding piece of flying that on a day like today. Looking embarrassed, he's not going to get out now. But ladies and gentlemen, put Morgan in the Ryan SDA. If you care to return your attention to the sky, running in from the left now. Led by the Hooker Demon. Fighters of the 1930s. Demon being flown today by Rob Millichip. On his left wing, American. Being flown by Stu Goldsmith. And closest to the Gladiator, being flown by Paul Stone. To Hawkers and said, can you make a fighter version of it? And that's the aircraft you see here, the Hawker Demon. They cut the back cockpit out a bit further to give the rear gunner a much better field of fire. Did away with the bombing equipment. And added a pair of 303 machine guns in the nose for the pilot. Rear gunner having a 303 machine gun, normally either a Vickers or a Lewis, First World War vintage, mounted on a ring around the rear cockpit so you can move it in any direction. And these served as interim fighters right the way through the 1930s, right up until the introduction of one of the other aircraft that was joining this in company, of course the Hawker Hurricane, first flew in 1936. Started replacing the Demon as a frontline fighter. Number of the Demons are actually modified on the production line from halves. This particular aircraft, originally built by Bolton Paul under license to Hawkers in Wolverhampton. And it really is a remarkable story, this airframe. 35,000 hours went into restoring this aeroplane to fly. Over 18 years by Sky Sports Aviation, just up the road here. Parts came from the United Kingdom, from Ireland, and as far afield as Australia, would you believe? Fully restored, she first flew in June 2009. Making her debut here that year, the 2nd of August. The sound coming from the nose is familiar. There's a good reason for that. Sitting in the front, of course, is a Rolls-Royce Kestrel, another of the famous lineage of Rolls-Royce V12s. This particular one producing 600 horsepower. Gave the Hawker Demon a maximum speed of 182 miles an hour. Now this was one of the aircraft. What's most important about the Hart series isn't what they did, funnily enough. It's what they taught hawkers. Because Sidney Catt, who's the chief designer of hawkers there, and Fred Sigrist came up with a method of building aeroplanes which didn't need welding. All it was basically metal tubes that were squashed to square section in places, drilled through, and were bolted together. Now that meant they were very, very easy to build quickly, and they were very easy to repair. Repair a Hurricane a lot faster than you could a Spitfire, and get it back in the air and back in the fighting. Talking of which, running in from the right, the Gladiator and Hurricane. Centre stage in the Gladiator. Interestingly, the year the Demon entered service, 1934, was when the year the Gladiator first flew. It was the last biplane fighter in Royal Air Force service, armed with 4 303 machine guns, 2, one on either side of the fuselage, firing down trains between the engine cylinders. And 2, as you can see, in blisters under the lower wings. Double the firepower of a First World War fighter, but still not enough. Hence the reason why when the tender went out for a new fighter, the Air Ministry insisted on doubling it again to 8 303 machine guns. Interestingly, one of the first aircraft to feature a fully enclosed cockpit, certainly one of the first RAF fighters to feature a fully enclosed cockpit, which most pilots, when they flew them, actually left them open because they weren't used to it and they didn't like that shut-in feeling, as they described it. This particular aircraft, its real registration is L8032. It was the last production Gladiator ever built. A total of 477 were built for the Royal Air Force in the Mark 1 and Mark 2 variant, and also, of course, in the Sea Gladiator variant for the Fleet Air Arm. Of an aircraft of number 73 squadron, K7958. This particular aircraft was flown at one of the famous Hendon Air pageants in the 1930s by an Irish pilot, Cobber Kane, who would later go on to become one of the top scoring pilots at the Battle of Britain. By an 840 horsepower Bristol Mercury. Gave the aircraft, gave the Gladiator a maximum speed of 253 miles an hour. Most famous, of course, for embarking aboard HMS Glorious to take part in the ill-fated defence of Norway. And also, three of them, well actually there were 5 aircraft, they just kept 2 as spares to keep the other 3 airworthy. 3 of them at one time were the only air defence of Malta in the Mediterranean. There were still 2 squadrons of Gladiators operating in the UK during the Battle of Britain earlier. My favourite Second World War fighter, often overlooked, actually shot down more German aircraft during the Battle of Britain than all the other defences put together. Okay, I reckon. Stu Goldstein flying the aircraft for us today. Now this, as they say, is an aircraft with a pedigree. This particular aeroplane, built during the Battle of Britain in 1940, delivered to number 605 Squadron. On the 17th of August of that year, at the height of the Battle of Britain, they were then based at Drem in Scotland, and they soon moved south to Croydon, where this particular aircraft was responsible for shooting down five enemy aircraft. The way you're looking at there, ladies and gentlemen, is your actual Battle of Britain hurricane. A lovely thing it is too. R4118. Battle damaged in October. Repaired, rebuilt and issued to number 111 Squadron. At Dyce in 1941. Flying a number of patrols over the North Sea. It was again in combat against German reconnaissance aircraft coming across from Norway. Primarily as a training aircraft after 1942. In December 1943, she was crated up at Cardiff and shipped out to India. Supposed to be used as a training aircraft over there, but actually sat in its packing case on the docks. Bombay until 1947. It was donated to Bombay University to be used for engineering instruction. There she remained, slowly mouldering away until 1996. A restoration enthusiast and a retired businessman by the name of Peter Vasher began his quest to bring the aircraft back to the UK. Seen the aircraft while on a business trip in 1982, and it took him 14 years to get permission to bring the aircraft back home, so to speak. It wasn't until June of 2001 when the aircraft was all the permissions were granted. The aircraft was crated over and shipped back to the UK, where a restoration to this incredible condition began. It really is a beautiful machine. Beautifully done by Stu Goldsmith there, ladies and gentlemen.